this morning I'm going to be preaching against this book right here called The Shack. Now, people have been trying to get me to preach against this book for years, and I've gotten a whole bunch of emails about it, and recently a whole bunch of people have been coming up to me even at church and saying, you need to preach against The Shack, and people kept bringing it up, and I'd blown it off for a long time. But I guess now it's been made into a big blockbuster Hollywood movie, so everybody's going and watching it and getting all the wicked teachings from this. And the reason it's worth preaching about is that, first of all, it says right on the cover that it's a number one New York Times bestseller and that it sold over 20 million copies, even when this copy was printed right here. Not only that, but the movie just in the last 2 weeks has already brought in over $43 million at the box office, which means it's a big hit. It's probably being shown in virtually every theater in America based on those numbers. It's been endorsed by over 1,000 faith leaders across the country. But not only that, even Independent Fundamental Baptist Kent Hovind has endorsed this book. Here's what Kent Hovind has said about it. It gives the best illustration I've seen of the Trinity. I love it. These are all direct quotes. I recommend it. It's amazing. I've read it 9 times. There aren't too many books I've read 9 times. The Shack is one of the best books I've ever read in my life. There's so much meat in there. It is a fabulous book. We need to quit putting God in our box. I recommend you read it, and you can quote me on that. Well, good, because I just did. Kent Hovind says to his critics that have slammed him for endorsing The Shack, if they don't like it, tough. It's just too bad. I don't care. That's his message. Well, I'm going to go through some of the heresy and wickedness found in this book, The Shack. But first, I want you to turn to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, before I get too far into this sermon, let me just start out with the big elephant in the room about this book is that, number one, it depicts God the Father as a large black woman named Papa. Okay, so this book, that it's the best depiction of the Trinity. 20 million copies sold, $45 million at the box office. God the Father is represented by a large black woman named Papa. Now, why would a black woman be named Papa? But it's just this strange gender-bending garbage put out by Hollywood, put out by wicked false teachers like this Paul Young. But look what Romans chapter 1 says in verse 21. It says that because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. So this talks about someone who would take the glory of the uncorruptible God and make it into an image like unto a human being or an animal, a corruptible man, a four-footed beast, a bird, or whatever. This is known as idolatry. Now, let me just start out here by reading for you some quotes from the book, and then I'll get into what the Bible says a little more. Go over to John chapter 1. That's where we're going to eventually go. But I'm going to start out reading from you in this book where basically, this man goes to this shack, and he spends a weekend hanging out with God, but God manifests himself, herself, whatever this book portrays, their false God, as a black woman, as God the Father, and then Jesus is there, and the Holy Spirit's there, all in bodily form. 3 different human beings are there with him in this shack. Here are some quotes from the book. Then Mac asked, which one of you is God? I am, said all 3 in unison. So he say, okay, he's teaching the Trinity. Here's the first words of chapter 6 of this book. Well, Mackenzie, don't just stand there gawking with your mouth open like your pants are full, said the big black woman as she turned and headed across the deck. This is God the Father talking in this blasphemous, wicked book. Then on the next page, the main character of the book, Mac, says, am I supposed to believe that God is a big black woman with a questionable sense of humor? Jesus laughed. She's a riot. You can always count on her to throw you a curve or two. I mean, this kind of just mockery and wicked blasphemy of God, making them out to just be a bunch of clowns, like the Three Stooges. It's the Three Stooges, and they say, oh, it's the Trinity. Wrong. The Bible says our God is a consuming fire, amen, not some Aunt Jemima that you hang around with in the kitchen that just anything goes, just cool with everything. And that's what's portrayed in this book. Look what the Bible says in John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelled among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Look at verse 18. No man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, He hath declared Him. So no one has ever seen God the Father at any time, at any point in history. The only manifestation that we have of God is Jesus Christ. When the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, the Word that was in the beginning with God and that was God, because the Bible teaches that the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, that these three are one, that is the only bodily manifestation that we have of God. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, He hath declared Him. Look at John chapter 6, just a few pages to the right in your Bible. While you're turning there, I'll read for you from Exodus 33 what I read earlier in verse 20, where it said that God said that thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. Did you hear that? God the Father said no man can see my face and live. Not even Moses, who He spoke to as a friend with a friend, could actually look upon the face of God the Father. The only manifestation of God bodily is through the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He is God the Son, but there is a distinction between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and we're going to get to that later in the sermon. John chapter 6, verse 46 says, not that any man hath seen the Father, save he which is of God, he hath seen the Father, referring to Himself. He's saying that He is the only one who has seen the Father. 1 John 4:12, no man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and His love is perfected in us. Go to John chapter 16. So, number one thing that's wrong with this book is that God the Father is depicted as a large black woman named Papa. Number two, I mean, that should be enough right there to just discard this book. And by the way, the movie's the same way. I haven't seen the movie, but I read the synopsis of the movie. I read the entire book, and I can tell you it sounds like it's identical. Okay, number two, the Holy Spirit is depicted as a Chinese woman who is named after a Hindu goddess. A Hindu goddess. Now, I'm going to tie in the Hinduism connection, because this book from start to finish is Hinduism. Now, you say, Pastor Anderson, you're just on this Hinduism kick right now. And because you've got a hammer in your hand, everything's looking like a nail. And that's why, no. You'll see that I'm right about this. Believe me. Even in interviews, this author has said, oh, people are accusing me of being a Hindu. So it's not just me, okay? The Holy Spirit is depicted as a Chinese woman named after a Hindu goddess. Now, this doctrine of the Holy Spirit being female is pretty common. God the Father being a female is pretty new, okay? But the Holy Spirit being depicted as a female is not new, but it's as wicked as hell, and it's a false doctrine. Right. The Holy Spirit is not female. This doctrine of Shekinah or a female aspect of God is a wicked, satanic, New Age doctrine. Yeah. Look at John chapter 16, verse 13, and notice the pronouns here. Howbeit when He, the Spirit of truth, talking about who? The Comforter, the Holy Ghost. When He is come, He will guide you into all truth, for He shall not speak of Himself, but whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak, and He will show you things to come. In that one verse, seven times the pronoun He or Him is used. And He shall glorify Me, for He shall receive of Mine, and shall show it unto you. All that the Father hath are Mine, therefore said I that He shall take of Mine and shall show it unto you. 10 times in this passage, the Holy Ghost is clearly referred to as a He. The Holy Spirit is never referred to as a she in the Bible. The kind of foolish logic that says, well, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost must be mom. No, that's a false doctrine. Mary was mom. Mom was a human being, right? Mary was the mother of Jesus. And so the Holy Spirit is not female whatsoever. But here's why I say that this book teaches Hinduism. Well, first of all, number one, the name of the Holy Spirit in this book is called Sarayu. So the whole time he's hanging out with this Chinese chick named Sarayu, which is supposedly the bodily manifestation of the Holy Spirit that he's hanging around with. Well, what is that word? The first thing I did when I saw that word was like, well, what is that? Where is he getting this weird name? So I Googled that name, and what language is it from? Sanskrit, which Sanskrit is a dead language that only has one purpose in this world. It is the language of Hinduism. The only reason anyone studies Sanskrit is to read ancient Hindu texts because it is no longer a living language. And so it turns out it is a Hindu goddess found in the Rig Veda, the oldest Hindu scriptures. The Rig Veda mentions Sarayu three times, this demonic god of Hinduism. But the second reason that I say that this book teaches Hinduism is that Hinduism teaches that there's only one God. Even though they're often talked about as having millions of gods, once you actually talk to Hindus and actually look at their scriptures and look at what they actually believe is that there's only one God that just manifests itself in all these different ways. That's why Hindus can worship completely different gods from one another, but still say that they're all in the same religion, we're all worshiping the same God. See, when you read the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, well, anybody who worships any god is worshiping me. People worship other gods, they're all worshiping me. I'm the object of all worship. So Hinduism teaches that God can appear in all these different forms and all these different ways, but still be the same God. So whether you're bowing down to a guy with an elephant head, or whether you're bowing down to a monkey god, or whether you're bowing down to a female goddess, they say that they're all worshiping the same God, because God manifests himself as these different gods, and he has all these different avatars. And we actually use that word avatar, right, in computer lingo. Isn't the avatar, what is the avatar? Isn't it like your profile picture is considered your avatar? But the word avatar is Sanskrit for an incarnation of God, where God takes on a bodily form. That's called an avatar of God. That's exactly what this book is teaching, where God can just appear as a large black woman, but it's still God. And then later in the book, Papa turns into a long-haired dude with a gray ponytail. And that's God too, and it's all the same God, whether it's a Chinese woman, a black man, a Jewish man, a long-haired Indian dude, it's all God. Look, that is Hinduism, where they worship all these false gods. They use other names, other images, other attributes, sometimes even of an animal like a monkey or an elephant, but then they say, oh, well, these are just ways to help us focus our mind to understand the true God. That's exactly what this book is saying. That's exactly what Kent Hovind is saying, is like, oh, we can learn so much about God from Aunt Jemima. That isn't true, because that's not what God is like. God has one bodily manifestation, one! Not various avatars, various, he doesn't change his profile picture, folks. He's one God, and he has appeared bodily in one form, Jesus Christ, man, the man Christ Jesus. And he only looks one way. Sorry, God can't just look like all of us. He can't be white and black and Chinese and Indian and everything else. And it's wickedness to demand that God looks like you. That's wickedness. Because it's narcissistic to expect to look in the mirror and see God, or to look at God and say, oh, he looks just like me. That's narcissism. Now, if you would, flip over to Colossians chapter number 1. Actually, you know, you go to Revelation chapter 1. I'm going to read for you from Colossians chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. In Colossians 1, the Bible says, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image, who is the image, not an image, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. So God does not appear to you in various forms, as various people, various animals, various races, various genders. No, no, God has one bodily manifestation, and that is the man, Christ Jesus. Now, when we study the Bible and we see God having various encounters with man, what we see is man trembling before God. We don't see God as just being an anything-goes, sweet black lady that makes us food, and we hang out and talk, and you can ask her anything, and she's just so cool and so easygoing. No, no, when you see Job dealing with God, you know, I was just reading Job last night, and I was thinking about this book, and I was thinking, this is nothing like this book. Because in Job, when Job deals with God out of the whirlwind, Job is just on his face, scared to death, terrified. And you know what? God doesn't say anything nice to Job. God just proclaims his own holiness and rips on Job, even though Job was the most righteous man on the earth. And even though everything Job said was right. And when God's done laying into Job, he says, by the way, everything Job said was right. And this is still how I treat him, because I'm God and he's a human being. Our God's a consuming fire. And even when Jesus was on this earth, he wasn't just this cool guy that you just hang out with and anything goes. How many times the Bible say where people were afraid to ask him any more questions? Where people were scared of him, where people are falling on their faces. Even the demon-possessed are falling on their faces before him. Even when he's arrested, he says, I'm he. They all fall backwards. God is not to be made into the Three Stooges or just some really nice, cool, laid-back person. No, he's reverend. He's holy. We need to exalt him and get a biblical view of him. Let's look at John, who is known as the disciple whom Jesus loved. This is the disciple who actually leaned on Jesus' breast at the Last Supper. This is one of his closest friends, his closest disciples. When Jesus appears to John on the Isle of Patmos, here's the image that comes to him. It says in verse number 12, and again, notice, he's not seeing God the Father. No man has seen God at any time. This is him seeing God the Son, Jesus Christ. Any bodily manifestation of the Father or the Holy Ghost is heresy in the first place. God is a spirit. But it says here in verse 12, and I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow. Now let me ask you, is that a black man? I mean, look, if you're going to say that Jesus is black, you know what you're saying? That this book is a lie. Because it just said that his head and his hairs were white like wool. White is not black. White is white. And you know what? If you're offended by that, then you're a narcissist who wants to look in the mirror and God to look exactly like you, and that's wicked. You don't make God into your own image. God made man in his image, and he made a variety of men, and he made male and female, and everybody doesn't look like God. I don't expect to get to heaven and God to look just like me. I'm not saying that God is some kind of a Northern European Caucasian from Scandinavia or Ireland. That's not what I'm saying, folks. But he sure isn't black if it says he's white in that image right there. And to say so is a lie. Okay, Jesus Christ, when he walked on this earth, was probably light brown. Because if you think about the people that live in that region, you think about the Egyptians and the Palestinians, and don't let these Hollywood blue-eyed, red-haired Jews fool you. Those aren't even real Jews. They're from Poland. Jesus was probably of a light brown complexion if we just use common sense. But does that mean everybody in the room who's light brown should be like, yes, Jesus looks like me, yeah. It's so dumb. I mean, or yeah, he's white. Yeah, I knew he was white. Underline white. Yeah. That just shows the wickedness and carnality. If God wanted us to know what Jesus looked like on this earth, it would have given us a very detailed description. Is his hair wavy? Is it straight? Is it curly? Is he short? Is he tall? Is he thin? Is he broad-shouldered? It doesn't matter. If it mattered, he'd tell us. It doesn't matter. And look, I don't care what God looks like when I get there. And in the form of Jesus, of course, because we're not going to just waltz into heaven the first day and see God the Father. We're going to see Jesus. I don't care what he looks like. I don't care what he is. But I guarantee you this, I'm not going to walk in. He's not going to be Chinese. It's just not going to happen. And you say, oh, you just don't like Chinese people. No, it's because he wasn't born in China. He didn't live in China. He didn't preach in China. It would just be dumb to say, oh, he's Chinese. It's just dumb to say, oh, he's black. He wasn't in sub-Saharan Africa, folks. He's in the Middle East. He didn't come to Ethiopia. He went to Israel. And look, I don't expect him to be an Irish redhead either, because he didn't come to Ireland. He was manifested bodily in the Middle East. And this stupidity of making God a black woman is nothing against black people. It's just stupid because he wasn't black and he wasn't a woman. And if you believe either of those things, you're a liar, because that's not what the Bible teaches anywhere. And the whole fact that people are offended by that, and here's what happens. Whenever anybody confronts this author and says, well, what, do you really think that God's a black woman? He's a, well, what do you think? He's a white man. Yeah, I do. That's what it says in Revelation chapter 1. So put that in your pope and smack it. I don't care whether you like that or not. It's what the Bible said. And they're just trying to use race to cover up the fact that they made God into a woman. You know, like, as if that's the big deal, that it's a black woman. If it was a fat white woman, that'd be a problem too. Do you really think I'd be less offended by this book? Well, at least they made it a fat white woman. Do you really think I would care? You really think that would affect the price of tea in China if it's a fat white woman or a fat black woman in this book? But fat black women everywhere are apparently getting excited about this book because Oprah Winfrey loves it. Because of the narcissism of demanding that God look just like you. It doesn't matter what God looks like, folks. And if you think it does, you're carnal. It's his word that matters. That's who he is. Who he is defined by his word. Not just he's such a good-looking guy. Okay. But in Revelation 1, it says his head and his hairs, look down at your Bible, were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp, two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I was just blown away just by how easy he was to be around. I mean, he was just so laid back. He was so cool. It was just so easy to just talk to him in the breakfast nook. No, he said, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. That's the reaction when you get around the bodily presence of the Lord. You fall at his feet as dead. He laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, fear not, I'm the first and the last. I'm he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I'm alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death. This proves that this manifestation of God here is not the Father. It's the Son, because he was dead, and behold, he's alive forevermore. Let me read for you some more excerpts of this book here. Of course, the book just drips with every type of liberalism, every type of just soft, watered-down Christianity, and just anything liberal. Like, the first time you see God in the book, the main character has a gun in his hand, okay? Listen to what it says about the gun, you know, once he meets up with Aunt Jemima. It says, the large black woman gathered his coat and he handed her the gun, which she took from him with 2 fingers as if it was contaminated. First of all, that's bad English. It's as if it were contaminated. It's a subjunctive, not past tense. But secondly, why would God hold a gun as if it were contaminated? Like God's just afraid of guns, like, ew, guns. Jesus' disciples carried swords. If you actually read the Bible, you'd know that. Jesus said to his disciples, hey, we need to make sure we have a sword. And they said, Master, we have 2 swords. They already had it. He starts telling them they need to buy a sword, and they're like, Jesus, we have 2 swords. And he says, oh, it's enough. They carried weapons. He didn't tell them to be unarmed or disarmed. But yet in this book, and then again it's reiterated 3 pages later, that she was still carrying the gun by 2 fingers a full arm's length away from her. Okay, so early on in his encounter with Papa, which, by the way, Papa is the name of a false female goddess in Polynesia. You say, that's a coincidence. Oh, really? Because on the back of the book, it says that the author was raised in Polynesia. So maybe that's not a coincidence that there's a female goddess called Papa in Polynesia. He was raised amongst cannibals where he was repeatedly molested from the age of 6 onward. Wonder why he hates God so much to write this reprobate book. Listen to this. He finds Papa in the kitchen. This is supposedly God the Father, listening to headphones while doing the dishes. He inquired, "May I ask what you're listening to?" "You really want to know?" "Sure." Now Mac was curious. "West Coast Juice, group called Diatribe, and an album that isn't even out yet called Heart Trips," she said, winking at Mac. "Right," Mac responded, more than a little incredulous. "West Coast Juice, huh? It doesn't sound very religious." "Oh, trust me, it's not. More like Eurasian funk and blues with a message and a great beat." She sidestepped toward Mac as if she were doing a dance and clapped, all right? Mac stepped back. "So God listens to funk?" Mac had never heard funk talked about in any properly righteous terms. This is a few pages later. She again picked up the wooden spoon, which was dripping with some sort of batter. "Mackenzie, I am neither male nor female, even though both genders are derived from my nature. If I choose to appear to you as a man or a woman, it's because I love you. For me to appear to you as a woman and suggest that you call me Papa is simply to mix metaphors to help keep you from falling so easily back into your religious conditioning." Religious conditioning, translation, what you read in the Bible about God being male, about his head and his hairs being white like wool. Here's what she says on page 122. "I don't need to punish people for sin. Sin is its own punishment, devouring you from the inside. It's not my purpose to punish it. It's my joy to cure it." Okay, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I'm going to continue reading here from page 123 of the paperback here. So this is the main character, Mac. And the main character in the book, he's constantly making sense, and then whenever he makes sense, God acts like he's an idiot. Okay, their God, their false God, Papa. "Well, I know that you're one and all, and that there are three of you, but you respond with such graciousness to each other. Isn't one of you more the boss than the other two?" Saying, like, isn't somebody in charge? You know, isn't the Father the boss and the Godhead? You know, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost? "The three looked at one another as if they'd never thought of such a question." "What are you talking about?" "I mean, I've always thought of God the Father of sort of being the boss. And Jesus as the one following orders, you know, being obedient. I mean, I'm not sure how the Holy Spirit fits in exactly, but..." Jesus looked over at Papa, obviously trying with some difficulty to maintain the perception of a very serious exterior. "Does that make sense to you, Abba? Frankly, I haven't a clue what this man's talking about." Papa scrunched up her face as if exerting great concentration. "Nope. I've been trying to make head or tail out of it, but sorry, he's got me lost." This is the God of the universe being portrayed, by the way. "You know what I'm talking about." Mac was a little frustrated. "I'm talking about who's in charge. Don't you have a chain of command?" "Chain of command? That sounds ghastly," Jesus said. Okay, let's see what the Bible says, shall we? Open the Bible to 1 Corinthians 15, verse 22. "For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive, but every man in his own order. Christ the firstfruits, afterward they that are Christ at his coming. Then come at the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death, for he hath put all things under his feet. We're in verse 27 of 1 Corinthians 15. But when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued under him, and when all things shall be subdued unto him, shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So not only did Jesus, while on this earth, say that I do always those things which please him, and not as I will, but as thou wilt, not my will, but thy will be done, but even after his death, burial, and resurrection, after his second coming, after his thousand-year millennial reign into eternity, the Bible says that Jesus will deliver up the kingdom to the Father. Jesus Christ will rule and reign on this earth for 1,000 years, and then he will stop ruling and reigning because he will then deliver up the kingdom of the Father, and he will rule and reign now subject unto the Father. He's still reigning, he's still ruling, but underneath the Father's authority. Could that be any clearer, what you just read? I mean, there's no other way to interpret this scripture. It says, when all things shall be subdued under him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. So all throughout the life of Christ, even beyond the life of Christ on this earth, into the eternal state, the Son is subject unto the Father. Not only that, but it says of the Holy Spirit, we already read it in John chapter 16, that he will not speak of himself, but that he will take of mine and show it unto you. Meaning that the Holy Spirit takes orders from Jesus. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, chain of command. That's what the Bible actually says. Yeah. But this book just scoffs at that, mocks that, acts like that's stupid. Mackenzie, we have no concept of final authority among us. Only unity. We're in a circle of relationship, not a chain of command or great chain of being, as your ancestors termed it. What you're seeing here is a relationship without any overlay of power. We don't need power over the other, because we're always looking out for the best. Hierarchy would make no sense among us. Actually, this is your problem, not ours. Oh, really? How so? Humans are so lost and damaged that to you it's almost incomprehensible that people could work or live together without someone being in charge. So basically, the God of the Bible is damaged because he thinks that there needs to be a boss. In fact, I seem to remember this word in the Bible that occurs, 8,000 times. The most common noun in the Bible that occurs 8,000 times, Lord, which means master, which means boss. So God is just saying hundreds and thousands of times about, I'm the boss, I'm the boss, I'm the boss, I'm the boss, I'm the boss. I'm the Lord, I'm the Lord, I'm the Lord God, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of the earth. And then it's just, this concept of power? It's because you're broken, that you feel like somebody has to be a boss or be in charge. This is what Max says, but every institution that I can think of, from political to business, even down to marriage, is governed by this kind of thinking. It's the web of our social fabric, Mac asserted. So he's saying, even wives have to obey their husbands. I mean, even children have to obey their parents. Somebody's got to be in charge, right? Such a waste, said Papa. It's one reason why experiencing true relationships so difficult for you, Jesus added. Once you have a hierarchy, you need rules to protect and administer it. And then you need law and the enforcement of rules. And you end up with some kind of chain of command or a system of order that destroys relationships rather than promotes it. You rarely see or experience relationship apart from power. So according to this book, we're going to get in a relationship with God where there's no power involved. Sort of like having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. From such turn away, they're reprobates. That's what it says. Denying the power. Oh, so God doesn't have any power? All power is given unto him. He's constantly telling us 8,000 times that he's the boss in this one book, the Bible. But not only that, he's telling us that our wives don't need to obey us as men. Our children shouldn't even obey us as parents. We shouldn't even obey God. We should have no rules for our children, no rules for our wife, and God doesn't have any laws or rules for us. sound biblical to you? Oh, then you need laws and commandments. I don't know, sort of like the Ten Commandments. Sort of like the commandments that Christ gave us. Hierarchy imposes laws and rules, and you end up missing the wonder of relationship that we intend for. But isn't this the same junk that you hear Christians saying all the time? The relationship. The word relationship is never found in this book. Never. Amen. But commandment is. Lord is. Master is. It's a human paradigm, added Papa. So you're telling me that whenever we humans protect ourselves with power, you're yielding to the matrix, not to us, Jesus added. And now, Sarayu interjected. Remember, this is the Hindu goddess, Sarayu. We've come full circle back to one of my initial statements. You humans are so lost and damaged that to you it's almost incomprehensible that relationship could exist apart from hierarchy. So you think that God must relate inside a hierarchy as you do, but we don't. Isn't there a verse that says the words of the Lord, or it says every word of God is pure. Right. He's a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee and thou be found a liar. This whole book is just putting words in God's mouth. Putting words. Basically, if you listen to the author talk about why he wrote this book, his wife came to him and said, I would like you to write a book for our children where you put all of your thoughts in one place because you have such a unique way of thinking. That's what his wife told him. And the culmination of that was the shack. So basically, this guy takes his thoughts, his ideas, what he has, his unique way of looking at the world, and he attributes it to deity. Here's what God the Father says, and it's his junk. Oh, and then here's what Jesus added, my opinion. Here's what the Holy Spirit said, what I want the Holy Spirit to say. But none of the words of God, none of the doctrine of the Bible. Let me keep moving forward in the book here. That's the beauty you see in my relation. This is Jesus, the fake Jesus talking. That's the beauty you see in my relationship with Abba and Sarayu. We are indeed submitted to one another and have always been so and always will be. Papa is as much submitted to me as I am to him. Is that what it says down in your Bible there in 1 Corinthians 15? 27, 28? No. God the Father is submitted to me. Or Sarayu to me, or Papa to her. Submission's not about authority, and it's not obedience. It's all about relationships of love and respect. In fact, we're submitted to you in the same way. I mean, where's that in the Bible where God says, let me submit to you for a while? Mac was surprised. How can that be? Why would the God of the universe want to be submitted to me? This guy actually makes sense, and he's treated like an idiot. Because we want you to join us in our circle of relationship. And that's how you want us to love one another, I suppose? I mean, between husbands and wives, parents and children? I guess in any relationship. Exactly. So let's just get in a big circle, kids. I mean, how's that going to work in my family? I have 9 kids. Okay? I have toddlers. Let's just get in a big circle and we all submit to each other. Let's just let them run the house for a while. Let's see. Stephen, you want to run the house for a while, buddy? He said, no, I don't. He knows this is a trap. It's a trick question. Let's all just submit. Let's just make Stephen the head of the household for a while. Let's make Boaz the head of the house for a while. Why not put Anna in charge? About time a woman was in charge anyway. What kind of junk is this? But I'm not very good at relation stuff. Not like my wife. Well, that's because like most men, here comes the man bashing or you know, right? We've already been through the white guilt and the anti-guns. Now we're into the man bashing. That's because like most men, you find what you think of as fulfillment in your achievements. And Nan, like most women, finds it in relationships. It's more naturally her language. So basically they point out an intrinsic difference between men and women. That men find their identity in what they do. And that women find their identity in their relationships. Which is true because man was created to work and 6 days shalt thou labor and by the sweat of your brow. And when people ask me who I am, I don't say, I'm a husband. So So what do you do? Oh, I'm a husband. I'm a father. What do I say? I go by my job. I say I'm a pastor. I would have said years ago, I'm an electrician, right? That's what you say. I'm a plumber. Why? Because men identify with their works, what they do, right? Whereas women created primarily to be wives and mothers. So yeah, they have a natural tendency to focus more on human relationships. And then that becomes their identity of being Mrs. Anderson, being, you know, pastor's wife, or being the mother to these children. That's natural for that to be their main identity. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just an intrinsic deal. But according to Jesus in this false book, that's why women are more spiritual than men. Which is a false doctrine. Women are not more spiritual than men. Men and women can equally walk with God and equally have a relationship with God. This idea that women, and look, that's why you go to these liberal churches and they're filled with women and there's nary a hair-legged man to be seen. How many churches you go to are filled with effeminate men and women? Why? Because a hair-legged man doesn't want to be told to get in touch with all his feelings and bow down and worship Aunt Jemima. That's why. I mean, how many manly dudes you think read this book and loved it? A bunch of queer little sissies love this book. Yeah. Creates a faggoty culture in the church when we start teaching that God's a woman and you got to be emotional and in touch with your feelings and, you know. How about work? The Bible talks a lot about work, too. Yeah. This book just scoffs at work. Working for the Lord is just a joke. It's all about sitting out in the woods and navel-gazing. It's Hindu. Christianity is about working and building something. That's why the Western world has actually built this whole world. Because of Christianity. Not because of skin color or any other dumb ideas people have. It's because of Christ. And it's the Eastern mysticist Buddhist Hindus, right, who sat around building nothing. And you say, ah, Buddhism's so good. Yeah, communist China. Why don't you go live there? That's where Buddhism abounds. Oh, but Hinduism, then go move to India since it's such a wonderful place. Right? Wrong. Christianity teaches you to work and build something. Amen. And, you know, yeah, there are a lot of great Chinese and Indian people who do a lot of great works that they learned from Christians. They learn from Christians how to build something and do something with their life instead of going around and eating garbage and living outside and sleeping on the earth and forsaking their family so that they could go look inside themselves for enlightenment and reach nirvana. You say, well, this preaching's offensive. I'm never coming back. Good, I'll give you the whole thing while you're here. Then you won't have to come back. I'm giving you everything right now. That the only right religion is Christianity. Amen. The only true God is the God of the Bible. Amen. The only manifestation of that God is the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the only bodily form he's ever appeared in or ever will appear in. Amen. Jesus. And Buddhism and Hinduism teach people to fail at life.
That's right.
And Christianity teaches people to succeed at life and build something.
Amen.
Ah, you're a racist. Get out of here with your stupid racist garbage. Accuse me of whatever you want. You call me whatever you want. Everybody who knows my doctrine knows that I believe that God made all nations of the earth of one blood. The only race is the human race. The only race in the Bible is run the race.
Amen.
Sit there and put me on some guilt trip for being a white man? Get out of here. Take that stupid liberal crap somewhere else. I'm not interested.
Amen.
I've always wondered why men have been in charge. I didn't. I never wondered that. Mac said, I've always wondered why men have been in charge. Males seem to be the cause of so much of the pain in the world. Now the male guilt. They account for most of the crimes, and many of those are perpetuated against women. And he paused. Children. Women, Jesus continued as he picked up a stone and stoned a fag. Oh, I'm sorry. Stone. He picked up a stone and skipped it. You know, he's skipping stones. Anyway, sorry. Women, Jesus continued as he picked up a stone and skipped it, turned from us to another relationship, while men turned to themselves and the ground. The world in many ways would be a much calmer and gentle place if women ruled. there would have been far fewer children sacrificed to the gods of greed and power. Yeah, because women don't covet. They're not greedy. They don't seek power. They're just perfect. Mac, don't you see how filling roles is the opposite of relationship? I mean, you know, when you're the husband and she's the wife, that's the opposite of a relationship. We want male and female to be counterparts, face-to-face equals, each unique and different, distinctive in gender, but complementary, and each empowered uniquely by Sarayu, from whom all true power and authority originate. Whoa! Remember, I'm not about performing and fitting into man-made structures. I'm about being. Oh, I get it, Max said, stopping in mid-throw. If the female had been created first, there would have been no circle of relationship, and thus no possibility of a fully equal face-to-face relationship between the male and the female, right? Exactly right, Mac. Jesus looked at him and grinned. It always comes back to power and how opposite that is from the relationship you have with the other two. I'd love to experience that with you and with my wife. You mean, Mac quipped, I got to read another part here. Okay, Jesus ignored his question. Mac, just like love, submission is not something that you can do, especially not on your own. Apart from my life inside you, you can't submit to your wife or your children or anyone else in your life, including Papa. So I'm not going to be able to submit to Boaz if I don't get a relationship with the Hindu gods here that he wants me to talk to. You mean, Mac quipped, that I can't just ask, what would Jesus do? You know, WWJD? Jesus chuckled. Good intentions, bad idea. Let me know how it works for you if that's the way you choose to go. So the Jesus in this book is mocking the concept of what would Jesus do. He paused and grew sober. Seriously. My life was not meant to be an example to copy. Okay, look if you would at John chapter, put one finger in John 13, Gospel of John chapter 13, and then go to 1 Peter chapter 2. Gospel of John chapter 13, 1 Peter chapter 2. Jesus in this book says, my life was not meant to be an example to copy. What he's scoffing at the idea of what would Jesus do. He's saying, hey, the people who came out with that bracelet, their heart was in the right place, but it was a terrible idea because my life was not meant to be an example to copy. That's what he just said. Come look at it after the service if you don't believe me. How about this verse, John chapter 13, verse 15. For I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his steps. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. He gave us an example to follow in his steps, to be like Christ, to be a Christian, right? But he says, no, my life's not an example to follow. Let me flip forward to the next point here in the book. This is on page 164, and the book changes gears here and is talking about basically the fact that every single person, this book teaches, that every person is a child of God. Everybody's a child of God, and that God will not condemn anyone to hell. That's what this book teaches. I'm only asking you to do something that you believe God does. He knows every person ever conceived, and he knows them so much more deeply and clearly than you will ever know your own children. He loves each one according to his knowledge of them being of that son or daughter. You believe he will condemn most to an eternity of torment, away from his presence and apart from his love. Is that not true? Well, I suppose I do. I've just never thought about it like this. He was somehow stumbling over his words in his shock. I assumed that somehow God could do that. Talking about hell was always sort of an abstract conversation. So here, God is rebuking him for thinking that most people are going to hell and that they're not all God's children. There was no way he could sentence Katie or any of his children to an eternity in hell just because she had sinned against him. Even if Katie or Josh or John or Tyler committed some heinous crime, he still wouldn't do it. He couldn't. For him, it wasn't about their performance. It was about his love for them. So, and this is just one excerpt. Many times in the book, it's made crystal clear that every person is a child of God and nobody's going to hell. Nobody's going to hell. God would never. God's just all love. There's no wrath. The God of this book scoffs when the wrath of God is brought up. Just like, what are you talking about? Are you nuts? The wrath of God? Are you serious? But what does the Bible say? The Bible says, but as many as received him, talking about Jesus, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And the Bible also says that ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. You become a child of God by believing on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, meaning that you weren't one previously. Only those who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ are his children. Would God ever send any of his children to hell? Of course not. Of course God will never send his children to hell, but the lie in here is that everybody's a child of God. The Bible says, broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Now, I'm going to finish the points tonight of what's in this book, because there's too much for one sermon, too much heresy. And it's good to actually go to the Bible and see what the Bible really teaches.
Right.
Because a lot of people, they might have false ideas about the Trinity or about, just the way God has manifested himself in human form, the nature of God, whether Jesus' life is an example. So it gives us an opportunity to look at scriptures and get the truth. I have 17 points in my sermon, and we only got to 6. So the other 11 are for tonight, all right, from this awful book. But I do want to conclude on a few thoughts after seeing those 6 damning things about this book. Number 1, that God the Father was depicted as a large black woman named Papa. Number 2, that the Holy Spirit is depicted as a Chinese woman named after a Hindu goddess. Number 3, that God the Father has no authority over Jesus at all. It's just a circle of relationship. Number 4, the teaching that Jesus' life is not to be an example unto us. Number 5, that every person is a child of God. And number 6, that God will not condemn anyone to hell. That's what we've seen so far in this book. And that's more than enough to discard this book. But let me make a very important point, and I want you to listen to this very carefully. And if you would, go back to Exodus chapter 34. I'm going to make a statement, and I'm going to prove it to you. Here's the statement. Anyone who loves this book does not love God. Anyone, I'm going to prove it to you. Anyone who loves this book does not love God. Now, the way that people will defend themselves for promoting this book, here's what they'll say. Oh, it's just fiction. It's just a work of fiction. That's what Kent Hovind and the rest of them say. Oh, it's just a work of fiction. Relax, it's fiction. First of all, this is not a work of fiction. This book is very deceptive and misleading. In fact, when I went on audible.com to take a look at the audiobook, lots of people were leaving a 1-star review saying, I was tricked into reading this book. It's misleading because it was labeled as a mystery or thriller. So they're looking for a mystery. They're looking for a thriller. Now, this book's about 250 pages long. The first 80 pages of this book, it's just like you're reading a mystery. I mean, the first 80 pages is a normal book. Like, I was reading the first 80 pages, and I'm just thinking to myself, this seems like your average murder mystery or your average kidnapping mystery. It was just like, okay, I've read hundreds of books like this. I mean, it's like you might as well be reading any mystery. But then all of a sudden, when you get 80 pages in, it just completely changes into something totally different. This book is a theology book. This book is a philosophy book. This is not a fictional book. The first 80 pages are fiction. The rest of the book is philosophy and theology. For example, if you read the book of Job, the first two chapters are a story, right? It's a story about Job, chapters 1 and chapter 2. Then chapter 42 picks up the story again. So out of the entire book of Job, three chapters are a story, right? The other 39 chapters are what? Theology, philosophy, right? Job, his three friends, Elihu, and then finally God himself talking about the nature of sin, the nature of the world that we live in, the nature of God. No one would classify Job as the historical books of the Bible or as a Bible storybook, because 90% of the book of Job is not a story. 90% is what? Talking about doctrine. Talking about, does everybody understand what I'm saying? So just because you start out, it'd be like if I wrote a book and I said, so I got in my car, here's my book, my fictional book by Steven Anderson. I got in my car, and I got in the car, and I drove down the road, and I drove to L.A., and I walked into a coffee shop, and God was there, and I walked in the coffee shop, and I sat down with God, and I talked to God for the next 8 hours, and here's what we talked about. And then it's all just theology and philosophy. My own thoughts, my own doctrine that's false doctrine, put into the mouth of God. And then I'll just say, oh, it's just fiction. It's just, this book's not even a story. I mean, the first 80 pages are a story to suck people in to the story. And then it just switches to just filling your mind with all this garbage. So it's a bait and switch. And all these unsaved worldly people were angered by it, saying like, you know, I bought this book because I thought it was a mystery. It was in the mystery section. And in the first 80 pages, I was into the story. And then all of a sudden, it became stuff that I have no interest in. I'm not interested in theology. I'm not interested in philosophy. Oh, it's just fiction. It's just fiction. Okay. Well, let me put it to you this way. Let's say that you love your wife before I get into that, let's put it this way. It's a work of fiction. Okay, if it's a work of fiction, then why did Kent Hovind say that he's gotten just tons and tons of emails saying that the book changed their life? Now, if it's just a work of fiction, then how did it change your life? And if it's just a work of fiction, then why do the people on the back of the book say, oh man, I repented of my lack of faith. I'm now craving the presence of God. It changed my life. It changed my devotion. If it's a work of fiction, then why is it supposedly so life-changing and everybody saying, I have a different walk with God now? You know why? Because now you're walking with Jemima instead of Jehovah. That's why you changed your walk with God. But they say, oh, it changed my life, changed my walk with God. But then you point out the lies and it's just, oh, it's just fiction. Okay, well, what about this? Let's say somebody's married to, because remember, it's all about relationship. Let's say somebody's married to a woman for 20 years, okay? And then that person, after being married to their wife for 20 years, that guy goes out and spends a weekend with a different woman. That's not his wife. And he spends a weekend with a different woman that is nothing like his wife. She doesn't look like his wife. She doesn't act like his wife. She does not have the same beliefs as his wife. Different skin color, different hair, just a completely different woman. And he spends a weekend with this strange woman. And then he comes back and says, oh, now I understand what it really means to have a deep relationship with a woman. Now I understand intimacy. Oh, it's so great. I'm such a better husband now. I'm such a better husband because I've come back now understanding the man-woman relationship so much better after spending a weekend with this other woman that's nothing like my wife. What would you say about that man? Would you say that he loves his wife? Then how are you saying that somebody who reads this book loves God? This is a God that looks nothing like the God of the Bible, believes nothing like the Bible, the God of the Bible, talks nothing like the God of the Bible, has nothing in common with the God of the Bible. People spend time with this God, and then they come back and say, oh, I just love God so much more now that I went a-whoring with a different God. Right. Now look down at your Bible there in Exodus chapter 34, because the Bible always calls worshiping other gods going a-whoring. It says in verse 12, take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it be for a snare in the midst of thee. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves, for thou shalt worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they go a whoring after other gods, and do sacrifice unto other gods, and one call thee, and thou eat of his sacrifice, and thou take of their daughters unto thy sons, and their daughters go a whoring after their gods, and make thy son go a whoring after their gods. It's whoring. It's a spiritual adultery when you're hanging out with some other god, bowing down to some other god, worshiping some other god, reading about another god and preferring that god to the real god. No, the New Testament didn't change your life. The shack changed your life. Oh, the New Testament just got me all into just legalism and, oh, churchianity. And, oh, the chain of command. I have to actually obey Christ. I mean, all that stuff about wives obeying their husbands and children obey your parents. I mean, the God of the Bible is such a drag. They prefer this fat black mama instead of the God of the Bible. They prefer that God. Why? Because they don't love God. No one who reads this book loves God if they like this book. You say, well, you say that about Ken Hovind? I don't care who it is. Anybody who loves this book doesn't love God. If the shoe fits, put it on.
Amen.
Well, I thought you like him. You know what? Look, I don't care if my best friend or my brother or my sister or anybody promotes this kind of wicked garbage, I'll call them out. I don't care if it's a pastor that I ordained and laid hands on, which, you know, thank God I don't believe will ever happen with any of the ones that we've sent out. Amen?
Amen.
I don't care who's promoting it. You know, we're not supposed to just have this, just loyalty to our buddies or something. No. If you're going to teach this kind of a whoredom, this is not the God of the Bible, folks. I dare you to come defend this garbage to me after the service. No one will. I mean, I know everybody here agrees or else you wouldn't even come to a church like this. But the point is that anybody who loves this book doesn't love God, or else then I could just go into the arms of a strange woman and then claim that makes me love my wife more. Because I hung around with some Hindu god. What difference is that than you going with some Hindu chick and leaving your wife? Oh, it just taught me so much about relationship to be an adulterer. Okay, you say, but it's just fiction. Okay, well then why don't you write a fictional account of you having a whoring weekend with another woman? How about that? Huh? Why don't you go write a book about you sleeping with a woman other than your wife and then come and say it's just fiction? Huh? Is that make it okay? Because it's fake? I guess it's just if it's fiction, it can be sin, it can be smut, it can be blasphemy, it can mock God because it's just fiction. I don't care what section of the bookstore you put it in. When you blaspheme God, it's a sin. When you lie and put words in God's mouth, when you sit there and make other gods and teach Hinduism instead of Christianity, that is not acceptable. You don't promote this garbage and say, oh, it's just fiction. It's the wrong kind of fiction. And millions of people are going to see this movie. It's not even done. It's only been out for 2 weeks. It's grossed $43 million. I mean, how long do movies spend in the theater? 2 months, somebody said? Is that accurate? Well, we know this is good. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, you know, a month or two. I mean, this thing's probably going to make $100 million. Why? Because we live in a country filled with idiots, that's why. Because churches are filled with people who don't love God, and they're so sick of this book, they're so irritated by this book, and they're just, oh, that God, he's so mean, and just they just don't love Jesus.
Yeah.
So they have to make their own fake Jesus, because they don't love the real Jesus. That's the real problem. If you love your wife, you're not seeking to go a-whoring from her. And if you love God, you're not seeking other gods. You're happy with him. This is not the God of the Bible. And so don't be deceived by this. Again, I'm going to preach the rest of the sermon tonight. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that you are a great God. And we love you for who you are, Lord. We're not going to try to turn you into something that you're not. We don't wish we had a different God. who just has no wrath and who just is just this lovable fuzzball. Lord, we thank you for being the awesome, magnificent, powerful Lord of the universe, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. We adore you, Lord. We love you. We love the Bible. It's our favorite book here, Lord. It's the only book that we go to learn about you. And Lord God, I pray that we would shine the light of the gospel to a lost and dying world that many of whom are so disgusted by you, they'd rather bow down to an elephant or a monkey. Lord God, please, please help Christians not to get sucked into this fake image of you, Lord, but help them to get into their Bibles and know the real you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Song number 271. Lord, I'm coming home.